Parental discretion is advised.
This show is brought to you by Slice on Broadway, supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza, sliceonbroadway.com. And listeners like you, support this show at patreon.com/wrestlingmayhemshow. Just wait, just wait. It's the Wrestling Mayhem Show, 542 on Mike Sorg at Sorgatron on the Twitter, and I completely got the intro right this time. Thank you for joining us for some professional wrestling talk here every Tuesday, live.wrestlingmayhemshow.com and over on the Facebook Live. With me, of course, from Johnstown, PA, Floodtown, USA, but he did join us. He did get in his car, and he has some stories about House of Hardcore for later in the show. He is Bobby FJ Town.
So many stories, Sorg. It was a wonderful weekend.
It was a wonderful weekend. And also wonderful with weekend. Us, straight out of Dallas, Texas, it is Eamon Payton, the voice of Inspire Pro Wrestling.
Yes, I am that. Excited to be back. I haven't been talking wrestling for a while on the show, so I am got a lot to say tonight, probably.
Awesome. And also with us in the studio, he is back. Look out, ladies. It's Dan Hooven, photographer for the International Wrestling Cartel. Why are you shaking your head?
I don't know.
Are you still mad because I didn't leave the camera on your crotch?
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah. Crotch chop. There you go. Welcome back, Dan.
What's going on, Sorg?
Hey.
Haven't seen you in a while.
I know, right? Like this weekend.
This weekend.
Completely this weekend. Also, you were ringside for House of Hardcore. We'll be talking that a little bit later in the show as well. I'm sure you got some fun stories you were close to out there.
Yeah. It was a good night. It was exciting.
Awesome. And of course, you can check out everything at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. You subscribe to this and the other shows that we do on iTunes, Stitcher, Spreaker, iHeartRadio, and the video versions on the YouTube and the Facebook page. Follow the Facebook page, and you know when we go live here every Tuesday and some other times when we go live for other interviews for the Indie Mayhem Show, of course. We went live with former ECW WWE wrestler Kevin Thorne, who I shared booth space with on Saturday night and got to hang out with a little bit. And, of course,
yes, very nice guy.
Britt Baker a few weeks ago as well, of course, you know, you saw on Monday Night Raw. Go check out all those interviews over there at WrestlingMayhemShow.com, as well as drop us a line if you'd like, 412-206-WMS0 or Good Times.
Good Times.
Good Times.
Good Times at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Let us know your thoughts on the wrestling for the week. Any questions? Big questions. We take some big questions from there every once in a while as well. Also, big thanks to our Patreon supporters, including Bo Diggity. Woo! And our good friends, the Matthew and Jennifer Carlin's Foundation for Podcast Betterment, Edward J. Burke, Alex Carr's out there in California, and somebody named Bobby Snyder.
Who's that? I don't know who that is.
You actually gave this man money.
Oh, well, at the $1 level. Thank you so much, Bobby and others.
I hope he bought you some pizza this weekend.
He did not. But Sword gave me courage.
I did give you courage. I encourage you later. To face your dreams and face your fears. And we have some good stories out of that. Well, guys, I think the first thing we definitely need to talk about is Ellsworth Mania. I think most of you probably caught the end of SmackDown. We were watching it here in the studio a little bit. Ellsworth is now, as Dean Ambrose says, has more wins over AJ Styles than John Cena.
Yep. He hit an impressive super kick tonight.
He did.
I was like, holy crap, that was awesome.
Well, I didn't realize. So we have a little bit of inside knowledge here because Dan was telling me that did you say you refereed his match a little bit ago?
Oh, we were on the same show with Billtown USA with Diamond Joe Rogers. He had an event down in Williamsport. And it was actually the Ric Flair show. Ric Flair came to Williamsport to meet Joe Rogers. And it was Diamonds Are Forever. And it was named after Joseph Rogers, the former owner of BCW. And he was pretty James down there. But a real nice guy. He was in a tag team called Pretty Ugly, I think it was called, or something like that. But super nice guy. So it's always, but I ran into James Ellsworth. I never thought I'd be trying to say that, like, people would know who he is. You know, I mean, it's crazy how things can happen. But good for him. You know, good for him, man. He's a nice guy. He deserves it.
In a championship match with AJ Styles on SmackDown.
That's what happens. You know, you work for Joe Rogers, you're going to SmackDown, you're going to Raw. That's simple.
It's just the fast track right there, apparently. Really, I didn't know he had the connections.
Yeah, no, Joe has a direct line to Vince McMahon.
Apparently. Well, that is a thing that, you know, regardless of what you think about, like, this basically repeat of a Colin Delaney thing. By the way, I think it's been 7 years, and that's the role we can repeat.
Colin Delaney, I don't think ever challenged the world title.
No, well, maybe the ECW title, right?
Well,
I mean, that counts.
So he never challenged the world title.
Right, exactly. Not like the WWE title or anything like that. But it's still,
as JBL aptly put it, this is a belt that's been held by Bruno Sammartino for 4,000 days. Damn it!
But hey, for all the times that JBL's commentary has just been utter disgust for the thing that's happening in front of him, this is the place where it was most fitting, right? About how crazy and ridiculous this is. But either way, this is the most interesting SmackDown has been in a long, 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 long time. Right?
I disagree.
You disagree?
I think
SmackDown's been great.
Well, I think what Sword means is from
you mean from the brand split on.
That and before and everything. Like, still, just in general, I think it's kind of hit a very special crescendo for SmackDown itself this week. Dan, you had a thought?
Yeah. I enjoyed it. I think it's always fun when they can make you think the underdog can win. Mm-hmm. I haven't enjoyed...
They did a lot of that tonight.
I have not enjoyed SmackDown this much since Muhammad Hassan beheaded The Undertaker in the terrorist angle. After the London bombing. That was probably the last time SmackDown was good. Or when Chris Benoit was champion.
Cool.
Was he the only character they ever killed off?
They didn't kill him off.
Corey Wilson's father. That's right.
Oh.
And they killed Paul Bearer, too, and then got in trouble with their shareholders.
Big Show's dad.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Chris Benoit's family.
No.
To that point, I like that it feels like at SmackDown they're actually taking chances, which I appreciate. Like, let's... Not just the James Ellsworth stuff. Like, let's bring back the Spirit Squad to do this thing. Like,
headbangers.
Yeah. Like, and don't get me wrong. Some of it's hit and miss. You know, I'm not sold on this new Curt Hawkins thing. It's very weird to me. But they're trying something new and they're trying something different, and I can appreciate that. I can appreciate them taking levels of risk that WWE is often criticized for not doing.
And even the Curt Hawkins thing kind of throws me a little bit, because I saw him in action for Global Force back then. Was that June when they had that show? And he didn't, it was like, oh, it's Curt Hawkins. And he didn't really, like, stick out to me as, oh, that's a guy that needs to get re-signed. Right? Like, I didn't feel like he had reinvented himself or gotten better since he left or anything like that, that he was moving forward in any way. But here he is. I don't know. They just had an idea and they just kind of, like, appointed him to it, I thought.
Which is kind of, other than like the fax thing, which is kind of an old Matt Hardy thing, you can argue. I just watched the pay-per-view and then this, and I'm like, so you're just giving him the Eva Marie gimmick?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I thought about that too. Except he's doing his own intro.
He never has a match, but I don't know.
Well, we'll see how far they take it if he gets suspended for 30 days on the wellness policy next.
Yeah, well.
There should be no such thing as a wellness policy in the WWE. That has ruined wrestling.
You think so?
I do.
Have we talked to Hooven since the Ryback has departed?
I think we talked to you right after he left, right?
Yeah, Ryback's killing it on Snapchat. His Snapchat's unbelievable. Have you guys ever seen his Snapchat?
No, not lately.
His Snapchat's out of control. He's basically showing the character that he should have been in WWE. He is fantastic on Snapchat.
It was weird. They were playing some old Hell in a Cells on the network, on the stream. And remembering in 2012
CM Punk,
that we headlined Ryback and CM Punk ending the show with Ryback on top of the cage. Like, wow.
They missed the boat on him so bad. They missed the boat on him so bad. I could have been a main event superstar.
Absolutely. Well, he was a main event superstar.
Imagine if there was no wellness policy, how big he would be. That mm-hmm. would be amazing. Imagine Ryback on steroids.
You heard it here first. Wrestling Mayhem Show goes to places that you know you never think we would go.
Seriously, Ryback.
Wrestling needs more steroids.
It really, this is your Ryback. On steroids.
Really? I mean, wrestling is one of larger than life characters. Who cares if they want to do steroids? God bless them. They're braver than me.
Mm-hmm. Well,
this has been up the down staircase.
I love this Wrestling Mayhem Show.
Well, we've talked about this in the past with you, Hooven, about your preference in wrestlers, of course. Well, okay. Speaking of preference, some of the big guys coming back. Goldberg.
No,
not digging it.
I wasn't a WCW kid. At the end of the day, an undefeated streak in wrestling, it's not really undefeated. It's just part of the storyline.
Right.
You know? Yeah, I didn't like the only good thing out of WCW back in the Monday Night Wars for me that I liked, everybody likes different things. I enjoyed Chris Jericho and mm-hmm. Scott Steiner. And that's really all I needed from WCW.
Now we see where you're where you're going with this.
But hey, according to Michael Cole, Goldberg is the official greatest WCW champion of all time. Which I thought that was a really bold statement.
I enjoy how they reinvent history. I really do.
I think I brought this up last week or the week before. Like they're saying, hey, Goldberg's coming back next week. By the way, here's watch the Monday Night War where we completely trashed his in-ring ability.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, here's that WrestleMania match he had with Brock Lesnar last time. Please don't look up the unedited version.
We just want you to remember Goldberg.
Oh.
Yeah. His speech last night I watched back, it was nice, but yeah, I just don't have any desire for that match. Mm-hmm. Well, for two reasons. One, I feel like it's just to promote a video game.
2K WWE 17.
Like when Goldberg's title card when he is entering has the 2K17 logo on it for some reason.
I think there was also a rumor that 2K was part in giving money to make this match happen.
Well, if you think about it, this is literally mirroring the movie Rocky Balboa, where a simulated mm-hmm. fight has now created this hoopla over what would happen if Goldberg and Brock Lesnar got in the ring together. Yeah,
it just feels
too much like TNA when they were like, let's make the video game character Suicide an actual wrestler.
I thought that was smart. From a marketing point of view, that was super smart, I thought. They tried to do a product tie-in. Mm-hmm. You know, it's kind of like when the WWE tried to do a pay-per-view where you would watch No Holds Barred and then watch Zeus Face Hogan. Mm-hmm. They tried.
Mm-hmm.
That's probably one of the better things I think TNA did was actually try to make that product tie-in.
I think it was a good idea, but calling the character Suicide was probably not the best of plans.
Well, I don't know if they...
Also because of the generic nature of the character, I think, also kind of...
Now he's talking about video games.
Yes. Yeah, and now he's the Cruiserweight Champion. Cool for him.
Yep.
And also, I think, like, both the fact that their previous match is not good, and Goldberg, while I liked his promo, didn't look... Like, he doesn't look... I don't know. You know, maybe I'm wrong, but he didn't look to be of the same caliber that he was in the early 2000s, which, like you said, Sorg, a lot of people even then critiqued his in-ring work.
He would if he was on steroids.
There you go.
And we do know WWE does not bother with the part-time people.
So which, what's his excuse then? He should be all juiced up and ready to go.
Which I think Ryback was actually
like
calling out about.
Like he looks like my motorcycle, you know, driving uncle, who I'm cool with, but like I don't know if he should be wrestling Brock. Yeah, like I don't know if he should be wrestling Brock Lesnar.
You don't feel comfortable with your motorcycle uncle wrestling Brock Lesnar. I get it. Yeah.
Yeah, but
what you said earlier about the first match. To be fair to both of them, though, they were on the way out of the company at the time.
They weren't
and they
the safe
did
match.
Not give a shit about that match.
They took three bumps each and went home, made their $50,000 bucks, and went left the arena. I don't blame them because Brock was going to play football.
Mm-hmm. Do you think Brock's changed, though?
I can see it going.
No, Brock's changed. Yeah.
You think?
I think so.
I don't think he has.
But I think he's more invested this time around. I mean, he's had some good matches since he's come back. Mm-hmm. Look at the triple threat with Seth Rollins and Roman Reigns.
I don't think he has this year.
No, this year, yeah, he has.
I just think back to the Mania match with Dean.
Yeah, like, that was
like, it's a case of like, if you make Brock happy, he'll do what you need him to do. Mm-hmm. If you don't, which I don't know, it says Brock off is a thing, you know,
Jimmy Johns.
Well, Jimmy, but also, but I mean, money. He seems to be like a guy who's focused on business. So if you don't maybe meet him in a certain way business wise, he may not want to perform the same way. You know what I mean? Like, that's what frustrates me. And then the third frustration is just that I think I mentioned this before, like around SummerSlam. I just don't like, it's now just Brock versus another big name, who can we find guy, instead of, hey, let's build Brock as a character and make him this unstoppable monster that will break some of our under.
That's gonna be so important though, because when they put a young person over on Lesnar, it's gonna be that much more.
Right, right. And
I just don't think they'll overdo it. Is my thing. They've had Lesnar for 4 years now.
Right. But how are you going to build Brock as a character
reputation? The crowd reaction was one thing, but if they weren't going to do it with Roman at WrestleMania, I don't see them doing it.
No, you don't build a guy like Brock as the character. You don't build a nostalgia guy like Brock or Goldberg as their character. Their character is their history, right?
But when he's going to be there semi regularly and going to be a big draw, I would say.
I think Brock just needs to grab everybody by the pussy.
All right, we're going to shift around our sponsors for the moment and tell you about IndieWrestling.us, where you can see Daniel Hooven hanging out at ringside at IWC shows on the side.
Grabbing pussies.
Yes, maybe doing that. Maybe. You can go over there, IndieWrestling.us. There's a lot of great stuff. Hey, $5 wrestling's back in a way. Premier Wrestling, Premier Championship Wrestling, featuring names like Johnny Gargano, for instance, like Matt Cross against Jason Kincaid in a battle of the beards. Guys like Dylan Bostic, guys that we're familiar with here in the Pittsburgh area, like Chris LaRusso, Jason Gorey, Facade. Go check it out. Premier Championship Wrestling is a new drop down over there over at IndieWrestling.us, voiced by the one and only Joe Dombrowski. Disco Joe Dombrowski. I need to find a new name for him. Premier Championship Wrestling, two shows up there, $5 each, their debut show and Battle of Beards. Go check it out. And yes, they're so $5 wrestling that they don't even have DVD covers. We just have the show posters. There you go. Awesome. Jock Sampson, Jimmy Nuts, Andrew Palace, a lot of cool guys. Check it out. IndieWrestling.us. Sign up for the newsletter. Get a free IWC show with AJ Styles.
All right, guys. James Ellsworth.
Who just lost to James Ellsworth. See him before the fall. Way before the fall. In like 2007, I think it is. Wow.
It's October. It is the fall.
It is the... Bobby? Bobby?
No. Just say Bobby no.
Bobby no. Bobby no. Bobby no. Okay, what else is going on in the world of wrestling? I gotta bring my notes up because that just threw me. Paige.
Diamond Dallas Paige.
No, it's a happy time for Paige. Now,
no, it is not.
Things have been weird. Poor Paige is under another suspension, another wellness policy suspension, apparently. Another up to the 60 days, the second strike. But then it came out that she's apparently proposed to
Alberto Presidente Rodriguez.
No, that's not true.
What is he going by?
No, I think he's just El Patron. I think he's just El Patron again.
No, he said he changed the name to El Presidente because of that MMA company. He's president now.
Oh, okay. Well,
so, yeah.
He's president of an MMA company now. He's opening up a restaurant or something.
He is an entrepreneur. He's doing press conferences.
There's also video of him backstage, like, playfully, like, choking Paige, which isn't cool. Yeah, well, she's smiling, but still, it's like you're choking. Still, like you're choking your girlfriend.
She's smiling,
but it's also weird. Like, I don't know if you guys saw this. Like, Paige's dad like made like a Facebook post saying he didn't approve of what was happening,
and then deleted it.
And like her brother also said like he doesn't approve of the proposal and stuff like that, and they apparently don't like Del Rio.
They didn't They called him that man.
Yeah. Like, this is a mess. This is a messy mess, and I don't know what to think about it.
Is this like Paige's self-destruction right now? Like,
this is amazing for so many reasons. Number one, God bless women. She has this great career. You know, she's on top of the world, traveling, famous on Total Divas, and she throws it away to fuck some 45-year-old. You know, so. So good for her. I'm glad she's making some very good decisions in her life. I can't wait for a year from now when you find out he's beating her on the regular and we're supposed to feel sorry for her. I believe that this is very suspicious, this whole thing.
Okay.
I believe that this is not an engagement out of love. She has to get him citizenship before the wall goes up on November 9th. I think that's what this is. I think this is Paige trying to make sure that their love can conquer any wall.
Wait a minute. She's from England. She's not is she a citizen? Is she not green carded in here or something?
Well, that's fine. She can give citizenship to Del Rio before the wall goes up.
Okay. Wait.
Yeah, wait. She doesn't have citizenship either then.
She's British.
Don't worry. When the task force is released, she blends in enough. She'll be safe. I might end up on the other side of the wall, too.
Oh, no. Well, I think Aim is looking for a way out over there. All right. Let's move on to another story. Jeez. This is, like, weird. It is odd when we don't actually talk about wrestling on the show, and it's more about
InfoWars.
Wrestling the InfoWars Mayhem show.
I'm a man.
Holy crap!
Paige and Del Rio just have demon blood. That's the answer.
Paul on the Facebook is adding Dan.
You smell like sulfur.
Dan, is you hit that?
I'll behave, man.
Well, there you go. Okay. He's still talking about Francine out there. We got a big. It's going nuts.
Sorg, I've been gone for like a month. What's happening?
We're on Facebook Live, so we have a lot of different people on now that apparently want to talk about Francine, and yeah, this is what's happening. This is what's happening in wrestling while you've been gone. I don't know what things have. I mean,
for the love of God, Paige proposed Alberto Del Rio. What the fuck? Like, come on.
Yeah, they were interviewed or something for TMZ or something, and I just watched the video of it, and it's so weird. Like,
I hope this is all Total Divas storyline.
This is going to be amazing. Like, Paige is literally, I loved a good train wreck because I don't feel sorry for people that are a train wreck. She's obviously doing drugs. She's getting married to Alberto Del Rio before the wall goes up. And she's out of control, and it's amazing. It's definitely like the self destruction of the Ultimate Warrior. It's going to be epic. It's going to be huge.
Allegedly,
and he's going to grab her by the pussy.
And yeah.
I'm sorry. Is this rated R?
Well, it is now. Okay. It is now.
I apologize if any of the Patron people are offended. I'm sorry.
Patrons. The El Patrons out there. Does that mean her name's going to be Paige El Patron?
I hope he renames her.
That's not his real last name.
Paige of the River.
All right. In other weirdness, as if TNA couldn't get weird enough.
Oh, God, what is happening?
We go from one train wreck to the other train wreck.
I feel like CNN because it's all like weird bad news right now. But wrestling's
Ohio,
so
you're
good.
On the air.
Live, yeah, you Anybody watch The Most Patient Man from C-SPAN on Last Week Tonight?
Yes, I did.
That
was great. Side note with that, I also really loved watching CNN and seeing Maria Kanellis on Don Lemon's show to talk about Donald Trump, but they only call her a former WWE star. They don't mention TNA once.
Oh.
It's amazing.
Oh,
wait,
oh.
Who?
Maria. From her, she was talking about her time on The Apprentice with Donald Trump.
Who's Maria?
The one was in Playboy back in the day.
Kanellis, yeah. Or whatever?
Kanellis, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. She was in Playboy.
His Rolodex is flipping. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I remember that one. Grab her by the pussy.
Oh, no. But anyways, yeah, Billy Corgan purportedly suing TNA. It's sealed up, whatever it is, but I guess things are going really bad down there. It's like a, what did I say? I'm trying to see what the note is on here, but it's a restraining order, I think, right?
I believe he has a restraining order on Dixie.
Right. So this is your business partner and you have a restraining order on them, apparently.
Keep in mind, they've also filmed like 2 months of Impacts with Billy as like the on-air president.
Right. So that's in the can. Meanwhile, this is going on over here. We'll find out sometime in November what that's actually about when they have the trial and presumably...
Well, we may not. We may not because the documents are sealed, so I don't know if we'll ever find out.
Meanwhile, apparently American Express or some division that handles travel expenses is coming after them for over $200,000 in unpaid travel expenses.
They're being sued by like four different companies.
Oh, jeez.
That's sad. That's a shame.
The world is a vampire.
That is rough.
It's a shame because, you know, for as big of a mess as TNA is, it pays a lot of workers' bills, and you don't want to see them like lose a job.
One of them
I mean,
just saw this weekend.
Yeah.
I hope they get their shit together over there because, I mean, those guys bust their ass for them. They have some of the best wrestling some weeks that you can see. And I just hope that everything works its way out. So at the very least, maybe the workers can sue them at the end of the day and get some money out of it. I just feel bad. It's like, I mean, seriously, you feel bad. These guys go out there and bust their asses and the management's such a mess they can't take care of things.
Right.
It's sad.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Especially with Broken Matt Hardy, who I think is the hottest thing going today in wrestling.
Well, rumors are going that he might end up back at WWE with that character.
If he shows up at WWE, because I mean, there was the one, I think at No Mercy or somewhere, there was a delete chant. It's genius.
Seth was doing a backstage promo on Raw where he mentioned the word obsolete, and you can hear the crowd as the promo is happening do the delete chant.
Oh, right? That's great.
Yeah. Which is good for him. You know, whatever I think about Matt Hardy.
Matt's been on top of things for a while, though, right?
He's a smart dude, man.
His Ring of Honor run when he was.
Yeah.
Like using his money as a crying towel and doing videos in his jacuzzi, it fits well. Amen.
No, I agree. I agree completely. You know, and good for him in that sense. Mm-hmm. But other than that, yes, guys losing jobs sucks, and I you know you always have to say that beforehand. However, it feels like, you know, We've been hearing TNA financial issues for a while. Like, this has been a long time coming when it comes to this kind of stuff. So, it's frustrating, but also kind of not surprising.
Oh, it's apropos for the. I mean, it really is apropos. They had so much potential, and I don't know. You know, they brought in Hogan, and everything went downhill from there. I'm not saying it's Hogan's fault. I'm just saying it. They should have stuck with their homegrown talent because one of their poster child, I believe his name's AJ Styles, is now ripping it up in the WWE. Even though he's not one of my favorite wrestlers, one of their poster children, Samoa Joe, is ripping it up in NXT. All these guys they sold out to put over Hogan and all the main event mafia.
Right.
It's sad.
Right. Oh, Eric Young just popped
up
as a major player.
Bobby Roode. He was Bobby my favorite.
It's amazing.
Favorite TNA.
It's amazing.
Guy.
I was watching that someone reposted this old video where they it's like the TNA Monday Night War in like 4 minutes or something on YouTube. And one of the clips is of Hogan, it's cut before with Hogan saying this isn't going to be about me. And then it cuts to a segment where Hogan comes out and beats down all the roster basically. And I'm like, wow, everyone he's hitting on in that segment is like doing great stuff in WWE right now.
It's like a touch of gold, isn't it?
It
just took about 8 years.
Yeah, it's amazing. It's frustrating because it's just like you want companies to succeed, but at the same time, like all the stuff you've heard about, like not paying their workers and the money they owe to workers and the money all these companies now, it's just like you can't run a business like this.
Right. Exactly.
I should have given EC3 is $10.
And there was also a report.
Steal money from EC3?
Because the report was that WWE only wanted the tape library. Basically, they were going to purchase the tape library and leave the rest of the company to someone else to purchase.
Smart.
And apparently, I think Meltzer reported on this that John Goldberg met with who's the director at WWE?
Kevin Dunn.
Met with Kevin Dunn and offered like a deal for the tape library. Part of it was Goldberg like wanting to get a job at WWE, basically like trying to weasel his way into getting a job. And apparently WWE was like, no, thank you.
He was a former employee.
He was Big John.
Yeah.
Tough
he
enough.
Was. Yeah.
Wasn't he the one?
Big John from Tough Enough.
Isn't he also the one that The Rock always wanted to use?
No, that was Kevin Kelly.
No. There was a writer that always.
That was like Dave Lasagna or something.
Okay.
Gerwig.
Lagana?
Right? No, Gerwig. You're right. Gerwig.
Right. Hey, yeah, right. There's some great guys over there. Lagana's doing great stuff over there. I mean that.
Ryan Gerwitz.
Gerwitz, thank you.
Gerwitz, yeah.
That's the one that The Rock wanted to use. This is a different guy.
John Goldberg is the guy. If you Google search John Goldberg, the first three hits on Google search is John Goldberg's a real asshole. Like literally, I'm not joking.
Oh,
like,
so it's not great. Okay.
Yeah. So I had a feeling. I think it was he basically tried to get a job through this tape library deal, and WWE was like, "No, thank you."
I don't know. And
I think that's really sad.
I think you know we talk about it's jobs for guys, it's opportunities for guys, but I feel like again the cream will rise, as we've talked about. There's some guys on TNA. You're like, how the hell are these guys on television, right? Mm-hmm. Like from you guys that do the Midweek War, and those guys will do whatever, and maybe they shouldn't be on TV. You know, maybe there's too many opportunities if those are the guys that are making it, right? But I think the best of the best. I think your Zimas and your Ethan Carters and your Matt Hardys with his new thing. I mean, are going to get absorbed by your Ring of Honors, your Lucha Undergrounds, and your WWE. I think it'll be just fine from that.
There are enough options.
Yeah, there are other options. It's not Japan. Like. I mean, even 5 years ago, Ring of Honor wasn't a real option for, quote, a job for wrestlers versus where it is now. And Lucha Underground wasn't even a thing that existed, right?
If TNA folded in 2011 and I was a wrestler working for that company, I would be scared.
Right.
But I think the business has changed enough in a way where there are a lot of opportunities now for guys, particularly in WWE, like, you know, they're signing up so many people. Like, it's ridiculous.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there is question, because I know there's been a little bit coming up about what they're paying NXT guys. Like, that's been a concern, especially since they're going and everything.
Like,
but still, like, it's still opportunity, right?
Right.
And I feel like that's the most you can ask for in a business like this. Right? Yes?
See.
Yeah, definitely.
See. All right. Anything else you want to touch on before we head out of here and head to our big question, guys? Anything else? Just stick. Hey, the quasi announcement today that the women might be main eventing Hell in a Cell.
They are main eventing Hell in a Cell.
I believe they are main eventing.
Is it official?
Mick Foley changed his.
Yeah,
he updated his thing
that maybe they won't go last, but you know, ultimately
they'd be stupid.
The fans will determine what the main event is.
Yeah. Either way, it's cool. Like I think it's people are. Some people have complained about like that they're just shoving this down your throats, and I'm like, to me, they're damned if they do or damned if they don't.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Right.
Like, yes, it's big that two women are wrestling in a Hell in a Cell match. Like, it's important. So of course you're going to point that out.
But
like,
if they're doing that, that means they believe in these girls, right? And it takes a lot to for them that to happen. Bobby, you've been trying to say something.
For so long, everybody was like, give divas a chance. Don't call them divas. To now they're saying, oh, we're pushing them too fast now.
Oh, that's what do everybody.
You want?
Oh.
Like, make up your mind.
You know, I think like, it's all just locker room talk.
can we?
Jeez. No, but I really think that if they don't main event this pay per view, WWE dropped the ball.
I'm a little bit behind in wrestling. What are the other matches on the card?
We're talking. The other Hell in a Cell ones are Owens and Rollins.
Okay.
And
Roman Reigns and Rusev.
Owens and Rollins should finish the show. And here's the reason I say that. So. I was actually a big proponent of the women wrestlers. Because I actually think that last year, the match of the year, no doubt, storyline match-wise, psychology-wise, was Sasha Banks and Bayley at NXT TakeOver Brooklyn.
Right.
By God, the match of the year. I don't feel like they're shoving it down the throat because I think the fans want it. But I think...
And the girls are earning it.
They're earning it. And they're putting on the best match of the night. I mean, I would argue that you go back to the latest WrestleMania, and the best match tonight was Becky, Sasha, and Charlotte. You know? Yeah. Absolutely. Here's my thing, though. And this is where if I was one of them, I would be bothered. They're almost to a point where they're saying, did they really earn it, or are they just trying to use them as a marketing tool now to act like they're being proactive? It's like the female Ghostbusters movie. You know, you don't want to become the token minority. You don't want to, they're going to do it because they're two women. My issue is that, and this may sound horrible, but Hell in the Cell, you expect the Undertaker Mick Foley spot. You expect something, even when Rikishi was dumped into a barrel, a truck full of hay. I do not.
Something spectacular. Shane just jumped off of one.
Well, here's the thing, though. I don't, as a fan, I don't want to see two women do something like that. I don't like when they get bloody. I don't, because it's just very, it's uncomfortable. It's uncomfortable for me to think about Sasha or Charlotte taking a bump off the top of the cage through a table. I don't think they need to do that.
The report was that Charlotte proposed a moonsault spot and pitched the moonsault spot, and apparently Vince shut it down.
That's uncomfortable. Why? Why do that to yourself? That scares me. Like, and I'm not saying that because women are weak. I'm saying that because I'd rather see them have a good wrestling match than try to do a spot fest. Shane McMahon does that spot because he can't do what those women can do in the ring, but right. He's expected to do the spot. So it's a double-edged sword. Either way,
I think the Hell in a Cell match too. I think it benefits them doing it at this time because the match has changed a lot.
That's true.
I think they can still work around it to where it can be really good and really fun without them doing, like you said, like doing like a big spot off the top or something.
I think the spot that we're going to see is going to be a spot where it's almost like the Jeff Hardy Edge ladder spot where one of them is going to be hanging and I can see Sasha Banks monkey barring the Hell in a Cell and Charlotte taking a spear on her.
I can see that.
It's uncomfortable for me when women get like, when they like beat the shit out of each other. It's just uncomfortable. Like, as much as I love Lita versus Trish, it's uncomfortable because I say I don't want to see two women seriously hurt themselves, which is kind of messed up that I'm okay with seeing guys do that.
Right.
Or even maybe her like jumping off the side, doing a moonsault into the ring or something like that.
And I think if anything, I think the Owen Seth is going to be the brutal one. Right. And I don't know what they're, I mean, I think
we're going to see a lot of weapons.
Rusev and Reigns is just going to be like, you know, big punching, hard hitting, right?
Superman punch.
The girls. What was that?
Superman punch, drive by, spear. That's it.
Bring Rusev's grandmother into the ring, Superman punch her.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Not the
Bushka. Or maybe Roman Reigns will grab Lana by her pussy.
Oh, boy.
But no.
Reach the moratorium on
it. It's not the worst thing that's been said on this show.
Yeah, no.
It's just locker room talk, guys. It's just locker room talk.
It's just topical. I mean, if they can say it on CNN, apparently we can.
Yeah.
We got to get that lady on here.
We're not getting any ladies on here now.
No, but I will say this. I really did people also complain that like, oh, it needs to be like something where it's like a big feud, like a blood feud. And I would argue that Sasha and Charlotte have that.
Yeah.
Like five years now. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I think that people always say, I mean, the Sasha Bailey match at TakeOver is phenomenal. I personally think feud wise and just as far as like a full package of what they've done together wise, I think Sasha and Charlotte have amazing chemistry with one another. I think Charlotte has really grown into being like one of the most like underrated performers on the whole show, really. Like, I think she's really come into her own as a heel. I think she's because, you know, great matches are great matches, but you need a good heel. You need somebody who can really sort of drive emotion and you know, create a good babyface to, you know, go up in the end. And I think Charlotte provides that with her work as a heel. And I really am excited for what this match brings.
Certainly, certainly. Well, we'll see. We'll see a couple more weeks from Hell in a Cell. We get a breather because we, you know, if it was a schedule that we've been on lately, we would be previewing Hell in a Cell this week. Yeah, but that again, that'll be next week, apparently. So, well, on that point, hey, let's give a shout out to our friends, Hooven, you had a little bit of it. Slice on Broadway, sliceonbroadway.com.
Glad to have another piece of it. Some good shit.
Get yourself a piece. Supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza. Thank you so much to them for supporting the show for a good while now up here in Beachview along the tracks. If you're in the area, go check them out over on Carnegie, PA, down on Main Street or PNC Park, home of the Pittsburgh Pirates. If you're in town, if you hit the airport, go check them out. It's pretty accessible, actually. Between town and the airport over at PNC Park. Some good stuff, some great pizza, homegrown, just a few blocks away from Mayhem Studios here. Thank you so much. SliceOnBroadway.com, PGH_Slice on the Twitter. Let them know the Mayhem Show sent you. And give them a high five from the Mayhem Show, please. Thanks, Bobby.
No problem.
And we'll be right back after this with the big question. Let's talk tech. Tech news discussions from the people in the industry right here in Pittsburgh. Online, gadgets, startups, and more. Check it out at awesomecast.net. It's the Wrestling Mayhem Show. The gang's all here. Sorgatron here in the control center. Eamon Peyton out in Texas. Bobby F. J. Town out in Johnstown, PA. And Dan Hooven joining us here right here in the studio. Still hanging. Still banging. Talking politics on the Facebook stream. So that got fun. But we got a big question from Eamon.
Oh, you want me to say it? Oh, okay. sorry.
I'll say it. What is your biggest gripe about pro wrestling today?
Biggest needless gripe.
Needless gripe. Biggest pet peeve, maybe.
Something that just grinds your gears about current professional wrestling. It could be anything.
And even if it's something that like, rationally you shouldn't be mad about, right?
Yeah.
I think Hooven has one.
I have three. They're all equally useless.
Okay.
Number one, I don't like that Raw and SmackDown are separate brands for promoting each other. I don't like that.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Number two, NXT fans in general.
Like Full Sail or?
Full Sail.
Like, okay.
Shinsuke, Japanese, Nakamura could go to the ring, take a shit, and they would chant, "This is awesome." Because they're trained monkeys.
Mm-hmm.
They ruin the show. They really do. I don't like when people chant, "This is awesome," before anything happens.
Or the one drunk guy on SmackDown tonight that was chanting it.
Or, you know, somebody shows up and they chant, "Holy shit, nothing happens."
Mm-hmm.
Shut the fuck up.
Goldberg last night.
Yeah, they did.
And number three, we've been over this before, this whole wellness policy bullshit.
Mm-hmm.
If they're independent contractors, so if they want to do things to make themselves look better, then by all means do it.
Wheels has answered his question. Wait,
and okay. Here's my rationale for that. The WWE lets the girls get boob implants. Why can't the guys do steroids?
Enhancement talent.
Yep.
I see what you did there.
Wheels is inserting James Ellsworth as his thing.
Now, good for him.
Answering
good for
the
James
question.
Ellsworth. You good know. For James.
Now because of Hooven, I've thought of three now. Two of them are kind of interrelated though. And they relate to indie wrestling fans. I don't know if you guys experience this at shows that you've been to up in your area. Is there a trend? I don't know if this is just the Texas thing. There's a trend of when there's a double, it's called like the double down where like two guys are knocked down, the referee does the 10 count, before they get up.
Right.
The referee will say one, and the crowd will go two.
Yeah, that happened this weekend.
Did it?
Yeah.
I think it's also happened on like NXT and stuff like that before.
Several yeah, times. I've seen it on the main wrestling shows.
Why is that a thing?
I think that's just fans. It's just fans being douchebags.
Trying to mess the referee.
But it's like such a common thing that's right. happening now.
Right.
Like it's so like. They're just trying to mess with the referee. Like,
We're in the age where the fans think they want to be a part of the show, and they want to affect the show the way they can, any way they can.
Yeah.
Paul's into Facebook. He's saying there's no real Lucha Libres.
Well, there won't be after November 8th.
Oh,
yeah, it. Yeah. He kind of goes that way in the next comment, actually.
My second also relates to in the fan wise thing. I also don't know if this is the thing that happens elsewhere. If there'll be a two count, there's a trend that they'll go two, and then there'll be fans in the crowd that go sweet.
Oh no, like, I haven't seen that.
I haven't seen that yet.
I've seen that happen, and it's not a cute look. It's not a cute look at all. It's really annoying.
Did you say did you say it's not a cute look?
Sork.
Okay. All right. I'll let you have that. I'll let you have that.
You do you, crowd.
Right.
You do you, crowd. And my third isn't related to that. My third is about the Cruiserweight, actually. Mm-hmm. And I actually had the discussion with someone on Twitter. I don't like that they have new ring ropes, new mats, and they change the colors of everything. I don't feel like they're integrated with Raw. They feel it's like a separate thing. And two, I think Sorg and Hooven can vouch for me on this from being around wrestling. That has got to be a bitch to as a ringside person. Like that's got to be hell.
For the ring crew.
Because apparently it's not new ropes. It's not new ropes. They have to tape over the ropes.
Yeah, it is tape.
And sometimes they'll do a cruiserweight segment, and then or do a cruiserweight match, and then do more of Raw, and then do another cruiserweight match.
But my argument for that is they have people that do that anyways and change the mats several times during the night anyways.
Well, the mats are one thing, but to retape
the ropes.
Either way, they have enough people to do it. I want to see the setup. I want to see them do it and see exactly how much does go into it. Because there's like 20 guys that come out when they come to set up for something, like for a Miz TV or something. So I mean, it's not crazy.
I think it feels
excessive because
feels unnecessary.
Because most of us here have witnessed rings being built and we know what happens. Or there's a reason why the rope was missing for half of the show when it was broken at House of Hardcore, right? And until an intermission where we could fix it, right? I mean,
I just think it's totally unnecessary, though.
Right.
I have to agree with you on that. It's. I feel like
I want to point out how much Hooven's getting more and more relaxed throughout the show over here. He's got his leg up and everything.
I feel like it looks more erotic if I do this. There we go. I feel like they're trying to make it feel special, but they're just ostracizing it. You know.
Yeah.
I feel like they're still setting it up for it to be its own show eventually. Again.
Well, it's going to be on the network. It's their own series, I think. They have They have the Cruiserweight.
Why is your foot up in the air? Don't kick the microphone. What are you doing?
I'm just enjoying.
Are you
life,
done
brother.
Answering the question?
Yeah.
I don't remember. I don't remember where you were going with this.
I just said they're trying to make it feel special, but they're just ostracizing it. And it's a shame because they have incredible talent. I mean, Cedric Alexander's unbelievable. All of them are unbelievable. Even the dab guy, though. You know, who doesn't like the dab guy? What's TJ Perkins?
The dab guy.
He's the video game gimmick. He's awesome. I don't think he's awesome.
There's a lot of dabs happening in wrestling, by the way. You just saw one this weekend at RWA. It's like, really? Really, is that a wrestling thing now? Come on.
I dabbed this weekend.
You dabbed this weekend?
Yeah. At IWC.
Oh. So, Bobby, that wasn't dabbing.
No, I did.
That was I don't know what joke I'm making. I'm sorry.
It looks good when Bobby does it.
Can I go?
Go, Bobby.
Yes.
My pet peeve is camera work.
Ooh, yeah.
And how sometimes when a violent, impactful move gets cut away at the last second so you don't see it. Mm-hmm. They're like, and they zoom in real fast and zoom out when somebody's punching.
It's called protecting the business, Bobby.
I know it is, but
thank you, Sword.
Because I'm completely, by the way, completely editing today, and I'm like, ooh,
did that cookie kind of connect?
I should probably use the other angle, you know.
Can I extend on Bobby's?
Okay.
I also hate that WWE still doesn't understand how slow motion works.
Yeah. Oh, the slow motion until the impact?
Yeah, until the impact that they speed up. That's not the point of slow motion.
Right.
I'm falling in.
Yeah. We understand you can't always show the impact though. Right?
Yeah.
But so it looks fantastic, especially if they're doing like a flip or something, right?
For everything.
Maybe it's overused a little bit. Maybe it's overused just a little bit. I'm starting to wear on the new camera angles. I forget if it was Lance Storm or Jimmy Corderas that said this the other day, and now it bothers me even more, said that they miss old hard cam angles. Instead, we have the floating camera that's the crane camera that's attached to the rig in the ceiling now in most arenas that just comes at you from the corner. Like, I even saw somebody on Twitter asking, did the ring get smaller? And they say, no, it's the angle, right? Because they're kind of above the one rope, which is, again, a little weird, especially when there's a tag match and you're kind of hanging out in the corner with the one tag team. A little weird. I mean, they're trying a lot of different stuff. Looks like they've abandoned the GoPros, by the way, on top of the posts. So
yeah,
I don't know. I pulled off the GoPro pretty good in Cage Fury. Just saying. The LaRusso and Palace match worked out pretty well. But yeah, I think that's everybody in the chat. Oh, I see Dan's making messages for Bobby on the Facebook chat. We'll leave that
I don't have it up.
That's okay, Bobby. It's okay, Bobby. That's for you. That's for you and for you alone later. Okay. So let us know. What's your gripe? What's your biggest gripe, reasonable or otherwise, with WWE? By the way, I have gone on the Facebook.
Or just modern pro wrestling in general.
Fans. There's a lot of indie stuff that we could get into, certainly.
Or Jeopardy?
Yeah, apparently people
want to tell us your complaints about Jeopardy and Alex Trebek.
That's right. Do us a little rap about it. That's cool too. Yeah. Somebody like cuts a rap about everything that pisses them off about pro wrestling, I'll completely play it on the air, no matter how bad it is. You may laugh at it, but
I play. If you like rap, you're a loser, Sorg. According to Alex Trebek.
Man.
Nerdcore rap.
Alex Trebek, come on, man.
Yeah.
Come on. All right, guys. Bobby has some stories. A lot of us attended House of Hardcore this past weekend, presented by the International Wrestling Cartel, Tommy Dreamer's group. Had a lot of great names there. It was insane, that card going on. Guys like Bob Holly, Ethan Carter, Rhino was there, his last appearance for House of Hardcore, and I think indie wrestling in general. And he was saying he was going to a SmackDown Live event the next night. And of course IWC had a presence there with a couple of matches, and Dan was ringside, right? He's nodding.
I was doing the ringside photos as usual,
as he does. Daniel's died. What happened? I missed the point that you apparently almost died.
Oh, I don't know. I was running away from a lot of things that night. Usually it's to protect my camera. Like, if I get knocked over, it's fine. Mm-hmm. But, like if I see, like, liquid being... I still have blood on my camera from Dylan Bostic's match.
Yeah.
When they were throwing weapons and stuff like that, Braxton Sutter's almost teabagged me by accident at one point. But if I see something that could hurt the camera, I run. Because I had to protect that with my life, because it's worth a lot of money.
Mm-hmm.
But I will say, I get a lot of exercise on show nights, because I probably do, like, 8 miles around the ring. I'm sore as hell the next day. I'm not really out of shape. I mean, I run, so fuck.
I think it was Rhino you ran from that we were all commenting.
Oh, yeah, 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 because Rhino, I didn't know what they were doing. I see Rhino out of the corner of my eye running at me, so I'm like, fuck this, and I kept running around the ring until I was behind him. I didn't stop running until I was behind Rhino and knew I was out of the way.
We laughed so hard at that.
You know, they forget sometimes I'm there, but, you know, my job is, you know, I don't try to get in the way.
Right.
So, yeah, I gotta run sometimes.
This is one of the reasons why we don't have live switching anymore, because our camera guys would be tethered, and sometimes they couldn't move.
Good.
So, good. yeah, there's been more than a couple incidents. So it's like, yeah, let's let that go. So, but anyways, so like I said, it was a pretty good night, as we mentioned.
It was an awesome night.
It was a great night.
It was like 500 people there, man. It was standing room only. All the bleachers were out. I mean, it was packed. The superstars were great. And once again, you know, next to Joe Rogers, I don't think there's a better promoter in Pennsylvania other than Justin Plummer. Personally, I think it was definitely the best show of the weekend. Packed house, big names, good wrestling. That Tony Nese and Matt Cross match was insane.
Yes.
And the main event, amazing. Dude, the main event was hot. And
Rhino and Sammy Callahan. Sammy
man brought it. Sammy yes. and Rhino. I mean, it was cool, though, because it was cool to see casual fans come to an IWC show. Because it's crazy how many people don't know there's independent wrestling in Pittsburgh.
Right.
You know, and it's refreshing that they can come and see that. And hopefully they come back, you know. And that's a win for everybody, you know. If we can make one person aware that independent wrestling exists in Western PA, that's a big win for everybody that operates out here. Because that's one more person that might come to your show, you know. Mm-hmm. But I was excited when the Mayhammers were out. I get hyped when I see the Mayhammers out there in person, so...
That's right. Bobby, Riz, the Carlin's clan. Yeah. Mason, their son, that is his second professional wrestling show.
Yeah, it's always good to see you guys out there. I get excited when that happens. I mean, Sorg sees my eyes light up when he walks in with his creative DVDs and gimmicks. And I grab them sometimes.
Sometimes or every time.
But yeah. I it's been a while since we were on it. What was the last show we did together?
You and I?
Yeah.
Weren't we both at Cage Fury?
That seems like so long ago.
I know. It was like 2 months ago.
I don't think you were at Cage Fury.
And then before though. That, I hadn't been there since...
Oh, like, yeah, he was. Cause, yeah,
like, I don't think we had worked together since like Meadville.
That's a shame.
In April. So.
That's a shame that you're a racist.
What?
You don't want to work with me.
I travel a lot, man. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry. Mm-hmm.
With the white people.
Build that wall.
No, there's a lot of Indians and Mexicans on the teams and Canadians. A lot of that going on.
You don't have any Indians on your team.
Not my team, but they're there. The Chinese are there too.
What's that supposed to mean?
I don't know what that means anymore because I'm not entirely sure what we're talking about.
Oh my gosh.
So you're way too relaxed over there. That's one thing.
I'm pretty much about to pass out.
Bobby FJ Town, tell us. So you had some encounters.
Tell me about this, bro. I want to hear about this.
You've talked about it. Recap real quick. I mean, there's this thing with Rhino where you never actually met Rhino, but you have a thing about Rhino, and you always said you were going to confront him about this.
I had a dream in high school that Rhino knocked me off of a tricycle, stole it, and rode off with it into the sunset. Up a sidewalk. All right.
So there's a visual for you.
And I've always said if I got the chance, I would ask Rhino to autograph or get Rhino's autograph and personalize it to say sorry about your tricycle. All right. Well, he was at the show, you know, and I was nervous to go up to him. I thought Sorg would back me up with this, but he didn't because he couldn't leave his booth. But Riz went with me over to meet Rhino, and so I'm next in line. I'm standing there, and I walk up to Rhino, and I say, "All right, this is gonna seem a little odd." I said,
"Which he loves when those start."
I said, "Did you personalize? How much is it to get a personalized autograph?" He's like, "Oh, he's like $10, like a regular autograph." He's like, "What do you want it to say?" And I'm like, all right, here we go. I said, in high school, I had a dream where you where I was riding a tricycle and you ran up and stole it from me and rode away. And he just, like, looked at me with this sideways look. And I'm like,
I really hope this becomes like a story that happens on like Art of Wrestling or something.
Yeah.
When he gets interviewed sometime in the near future.
Then his speech for state representative.
Yeah. I know. I was like, could you personalize the autograph to say sorry about your tricycle? He's like, well, like, I don't know if I could do that. He's like, I don't want it to come back on me. So he's like, how about this? I'll give you a regular autograph and I'll take your picture with you for free. I'm like, all right, that's fair.
I like he's willing to deal, like a true politician, by the way.
Well, yeah, I love that you negotiated that.
Two,
I don't want it to come back on me.
Yeah, I know.
There's some precursors. So one, I was goading Bobby to do it.
Like Vince McMahon's just on Twitter like, hey, you
stole
those guys.
Hey, Rhino, what's the thing about choices?
You gotta think about, and this I just thought about, like, he is a WWE signed person, so if anything weird comes out, like, that, he has to worry about that, right?
Oh, he stole some kid's tricycle.
Yeah, exactly. Like, he's like, is this gonna be a weird TMZ story they're not gonna like, right?
Yeah.
Because you have some kind of weird inside joke about it.
I don't blame him.
Which you told him.
Cool,
right,
like,
right. Like, so, but I'll you did it. But the point is, you did it. But also, you didn't take entirely my advice.
Oh, I didn't?
Because Rhino also had a donation bucket.
Oh, that's true. Yeah, I did. I didn't donate.
For his political campaign.
Yeah.
Sitting on his merch table.
I had limited funds, sort of.
And I told Bobby, I would have contributed to that if I knew that. before Kevin Thorne took all my change. But I said, you should donate to put something in the bucket. Because that would add a little bit. One, you're a contributor now. Okay. So it gives you a little more leeway.
Yeah.
Just like Donald Trump says. Right. Okay. Oh. We're not going that way. So I think that would have helped. I think that would have helped a little bit too.
I just read a disturbing fact.
No.
TNA has outlasted WCW.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah,
it's definitely fine. Anyway, I'm sorry. Back to this. This intrigues me about the tricycle.
It's a hypothetical tricycle. It was in my dreams.
It's Pavlov's tricycle.
But yeah, he was really cool about it though. We got a picture taken together, and I was like, all right, thanks for your time. He's like, oh, no problem, man.
He's a good guy. He's a class act.
Great. He's great.
He's really cool. He scared the crap out of me the first time I saw him.
And not only that, so Bobby had another encounter.
Yeah. which not
involving a tricycle.
Well, wait. I got a side one. So I'm at the booth, and a guy comes up to me, and I think he might. I think he actually bought a DVD for me. So I'm more than happy to help him, even more so, right? And he's like, "So I don't know who Candice LeRae is, but my friend really wants an autograph from her." And I was like, oh yeah, she's like the blonde that's out here. She's like the only one. She's been hanging out over there. I think her booth's over there or something. And she wasn't out. And I think it was before the show maybe. And it was like, okay, you know, come back at intermission. She should be back out at least by then, right? She does come out before the show, and I like see the guy across the way and run towards him and say, she's over there. So I helped a nice young man. I possibly stalked Candice LeRae. That was my story.
I will tell you, I was scared to death to talk to Candice LeRae.
Why?
I was nervous. I don't know why. I just at the end of the night.
What should Bobby have done?
Remember, she's a newly married woman.
At the end of the night, I saw her and Hornswoggle sitting at a table, and I was like, "Thanks for coming." And they both kind of looked at me and were like, you're welcome. And I walked out the door.
You should have just said hello to her. Trust
me. I love Bobby's interactions with pro wrestlers.
Like
the rest of us have kind of our angle well, in pro wrestling. And Bobby is still the fan.
I'm an awkward individual.
The awkward fan, which I still am sometimes talking to these guys. But still, like, Bobby is just the pure fan that is still like excited to see these people, you know, and I love it. Bobby, you remind us. You remind us every day about what we've lost. Personally. our innocence is lost, especially Dan over there. Who's somehow showing even more leg than he was before.
which encounter do you want me to speak of? There's two more.
There's two more? I only remember the Jessica one.
All of them. I want to hear about this, Bobby.
There's the Jessica Havoc one. The Jessica Havoc one, and there's the Matt Stryker one.
Okay.
Okay, I'll read the Matt Stryker one.
The Matt Stryker one's pretty cool. I was wearing my Lucha Underground shirt, which I got. It's a Pentagon Jr. shirt, or Pentagon Dark, as he's known now. I'm sitting there, and Matt Stryker sees me, and he goes, "Awesome shirt, man." I'm like, "Oh, thanks." And then I went over later, and I'm like, I should get Matt Stryker's autograph. I mean, I'm like a big fan of his, you know. So I walk over, and I'm talking to him about like things, and he goes, "I said, well, we're on the Wrestling Mayhem show. We do the midweek war." He's like, "Oh yeah." He's like, "I know you guys." He's like, "We mentioned your show on Lucha Underground." He's like, "I don't know if it made the final cut of the show, but we definitely mentioned you guys." So I was like, "Oh, that's pretty cool."
So listen out for that one, guys.
So I got his autograph, as you can see here. Oh, here's Rhino's autograph too. It says, "To Bobby, all the best, Rhino."
Subtext: "Sorry about your tricycle."
Yeah, no, sorry about your tricycle. And this is the Matt Stryker autograph. Nice. It says, "To Bobby, good luck."
And there's a picture. Matt Stryker. By the way, Vampiro, part of the picture as well. Vampiro, the guy that told Mad Mike to eat a bag of dicks on the show. So thank you. We miss you, Vampiro. Miss you every day.
But when I went to pay, Matt Stryker, he only had $20 bills, so he didn't have any change. Rhino didn't have change either, which I frantically dug through my wallet to get $10 for him.
I'll tell you a secret to what happens at IWC. Everybody gets change from Joe Dombrowski.
Joe Dombrowski.
He's the only one amongst the entire people that is prepared.
Oh, but the cool part was EC3 was right next to us, and Matt Stryker looks over and he's like, "Do you have change for 20? And Ethan Carter gives him $10, gives me the $10 that was Ethan Carter's. Okay, so I have Ethan Carter's $10 bill now. So I take a picture of the bill when I get home.
it was autographed or something.
I know, and then I'm like,
I love Eamon just has his hands on his face in disbelief of this.
I was like, and then I tweeted at EC3. I tweeted, I finally spent the $10 that Ethan Carter gave me. I bought a chicken sandwich, which he favored it.
What did he say? What did he say? Like big guy doing big guy things or something?
No, that was RJ City that said
that's right,
the comment
that's,
before.
That's yeah. Right.
But no, he just favorited the tweet. That was it.
I love it. Like this happened, and Bobby, the worst part is. The worst slash best part is that you're not the weirdest wrestling fan in the world.
I know you were so excited
to get a $10 bill.
I should have got EC3's autograph is what I should have done with that $10. But I wasn't sure if I'd need anything on the way home, which I didn't.
Missed but, opportunities.
Oh my God. Or I could have done what Farnsworth said and got RJ City to autograph something that said, "I'm not sorry about your tricycle." Which he's going to be there in December. If I'm there, I may get his autographs.
You're going to have that. Bobby has one more
interaction with him over the weekend too.
Bobby had one more story that we have to share here.
Yeah. Jessica Havoc captured my heart this weekend. In the match with Tommy Dreamer and Hornswoggle and Candice LeRae. And, by the way, what's her name? The girl that was in that match.
Allie.
Cherry Bomb, yeah.
She is adorable.
Mm-hmm.
I just got to say that. But Hornswoggle came out to the ringside, and he went through the gate and ran into the crowd. So Jessica Havoc's chasing him around, and the first time I was like, he went that way, and she touched my shoulder trying to get past. Then, on the way back through, he goes through again, you know, he escapes. She comes back through again, and I was like, he went that way. And she grabbed my thigh and said, thanks, and ran back into the ring. So, I was like, wow, that was a moment.
I thought I had a night when I was happy that, like, Mickey James brushed against me at ringside.
And then she spit into Tommy Dreamer's face, and he ate it.
And he ate it. I keep forgetting about that part of his career until he does something like that.
Tommy Dreamer eats anything.
Yeah. All right. Well, that was story time with Bobby FJ Town. You see why I wanted to share that.
So, RJ City also told me to get it together on Twitter, which sums up that whole weekend.
Pretty much.
Oh, my moment was talking Golden Palace with RJ City. That was a special moment for me. But anyways, also B. Arthur knee pad. And has he had that
who
before?
Else were we talking?
He's had that for a while.
Has he had that for a while?
That with? Was it?
It was everybody. There was a before the fans came in. There was just a group of.
Oh, that's Kevin Thorne.
It was a Kevin Thorne.
Yeah, it was Kevin Thorne.
Wait. Kevin Thorne was talking about Golden Palace.
Yes, he was with us.
Oh wow!
It was Kevin Thorne and Farnsworth and you and me and I think maybe Joe. I don't know if Joe was involved.
Oh, that was at that point. Okay. Yeah. Okay. That's what happens. Everybody talks about how Did You Know Family Matters was a Perfect Strangers spinoff and everything that happened there. So it went, so think about all the family having a spinoff. So that's where we're. All right. On that note, Bobby, I think you're recused from this because you learned a lot this weekend.
I learned a lot.
What did everybody else learn from wrestling this week? Kamen?
Oh God. Come back to me.
As if it surprises you every time. Daniel Hooven. What did you learn from wrestling this week? He's like sinking lower in the shot.
This is going to be in the couch next.
What have I learned from wrestling? I learned that any man with two fists has a fighting chance.
That's for sure.
And I learned that Paige is very concerned about November 8th when the wall goes up because she is now engaged to Poppy.
Well,
when life gets tough, you just grab it by the pussy.
Oh, had to get one in there. Eamon, how you doing?
I learned what Hooven learned.
The same exact thing.
You're closer to the situation down there, too. What are you doing over there? Hooven's like watching another show over on the couch, apparently.
Jerry Allen's live.
Oh, no. Like what? The STD?
No, he's Joe Rogers' brother.
Oh no, oh no!
I learned who Joe Rogers was this week.
Learned all about him from the chat, from the Facebook page. Actually, Kyle out there says that there will be nothing but James Ellsworth's face on the shirt of every person in the crowd in the near future. Welcome to it. Welcome to it. He can't not be on the show next week after beating him. That means this is going to continue. This is leading straight on to Survivor Series. Where we might be saying James Ellsworth needs to have a Survivor Series team or something. That also includes Colin Delaney, by the way. I learned from wrestling this week. I had an interesting conversation after the show where I was like, you know, I kind of wish Ray Lynn got put through the table. Not like physically, you know, but just like a good for her kind of point. So that's kind of how I feel about tables. Ray Lynn, friend of the show, good person. But that's all I got.
Yeah, but you wanted to be put through the table.
I wanted it. Well, because there was the tease that she's going to be put through the table. I'm like, great. Have her have that moment to be put through the table by Bubba Ray Dudley. Not the thing that I wish the putting through the table harm on her, but you know, she's a wrestler. She's okay. But anyways, guys, thank you so much for joining us. Dan Hooven, DRH Photography. Where can they find your cool shots online?
Oh, I suck at photography.
Oh, come on. I suck at videos and podcasting, but we're still here.
Instagram at IWC_wrestling. We just actually crossed the 1600 mark.
Woo!
On that. So there, Facebook, DRH photos. Go to the IWC Wrestling Facebook, IWC Instagram. I'm on Twitter, Daniel Hooven. And yeah, you know, let Plummer know that you like my picture so he keeps me employed. or else I will, you know, just have to, I don't know, pull Benoit. It won't get good.
Okay, and Bobby FJ Town is at Bobby FJ Town on the Twitter.
I suck at talking to wrestlers.
Yes, as we've learned tonight. And also, Eamon, at Eamon2, please, Inspire Pro Wrestling.
Yes, indeed. BobbyProWrestling.com.
Battle Wars coming up.
Yes, October 29th.
There you go. Go check it out, or check it out later on DVD and Smart Mark Video. I'm at Sorgatron on the Twitter. Thank you so much, everybody. WrestlingMayhemShow.com, live.WrestlingMayhemShow.com, 10 p.m. Eastern Time. We go live there and on the Facebook page. Thank you so much for joining us. We'll see you guys next time. Mayhem out. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at SorgatronMedia.com.